We're using RenderMan XPU in version 27 to render final frames on Toy Story 5. We've been working towards creating XPU as a final frame renderer that can replace RIS. During the history of RenderMan, we've always tried to maximize the potential of the hardware that we've had, and we've created different architectures for that. At first, RenderMan was just a scanline renderer because we had limited memory and limited compute, so a scanline renderer was very efficient. Now we have hardware both on the GPU and CPU that don't have memory limitations, that have a lot of power. So we've engineered a new architecture called XPU to take advantage of the GPU. RenderMan XPU is able to render on the CPU, the GPU, or both. And so it makes it unique because it's also producing the same pixels regardless whether it's using CPU or GPU. You can utilize, as an artist, your CPUs, your GPUs, and then send the frames out to render on a GPU-based render farm or a CPU-based render farm. Either way, you have a lot of flexibility. You don't have to think about that. So if you look at RIS and XPU with the next generation renderer, just rendering on the CPUs, RIS is slower than XPU. XPU is just a faster renderer. It tessellates better and it renders faster even on the CPU. You don't have to use a GPU, but if you do, it's going to render even faster. When we're rendering with XPU, we're not doing any caching, we're not doing any pre-compute, we're not doing any baking, we're actually doing like full light simulation. And that's one of the advantages of what RenderMan delivers, is the ability to calculate any type of light transport using USD as a backbone across all the DCCs that we support from Maya, Houdini, Katana, and Blender. And when you have those USD assets, you can take them anywhere you want. For the transition from RIS to XPU during Toy Story 5, we started rendering the movie with RIS, and we're able to switch XPU in using the same shaders, the same lights, the same assets, the same scenes, and just to render directly to XPU instead of RIS. So it's something that you can actually transition to seamlessly as a studio. For the release of RIS back in the day, when we switched from the Rays renderer to the modern Path Tracer, studios had to rewrite their pipeline. They had to use new shaders, they had to use new scenes, new lights, and for the transition between RIS and XPU, they don't have to change anything. So it's just a transition to a better renderer. If you have a faster machine, it's going to render faster. But for studios that are using RIS, XPU is actually going to be more efficient and render faster, even just on CPUs. And it's very performant on GPUs as well. The limiting factor there is really memory. So if your scenes fit on to the memory of your GPU, then you can render with them. So that's always been the gap. But with the new cards like the Adas and the Blackwells, the memory restrictions are going away. The non-commercial version will have the latest version of XPU. We think it's a great way to provide non-commercial RenderMan to the community so people can try it out. They can learn it on their own time, and then that gives them the advantage to go to studios and get jobs and enter the pipeline with a leg up. When we make things for production, we are required to allow the director to basically creatively direct every single pixel in an image. And because of that, we need to be able to have control over every pixel in an image. Things like generative AI simply can't do that now. So they're not useful in a studio where you need to have creative direction. So when we see into the future and how some AI technologies might be used, they'll probably be used as specific types of tools like for denoising or neural transfer or things like that. But they'll be more approached as tools as opposed to final pixels. In the immediate future, we want to land XPU for Toy Story 5 across all of the shots. So there's a few last things that we're working on. We're working on to make the make sure the pixels are perfect. And after we get that nailed down, and get that launched in October. We're going to be moving on to 28, and we have some things like optimizations we'll be focusing on, because right now we've been working to be feature complete. Once we get feature complete, then we'll optimize, and then we might start looking at real-time solutions or something like that, something more down the road and innovative. We launched our 12th RenderMan challenge. It's called First Contact. It's slightly related to Elio, so we're inviting people to take our assets and tell a story with them that is related to first contact, meeting an alien race, in whatever kind of story people want, whether it's whatever genre, whether it's horror, comedy, drama, or whatnot. The RenderMan challenge this year, we're adding a number of different things beyond prizes. So we have actual cloud compute for the challengers to take advantage of to render their final frames. We have a mentorship program where we have a number of people mentoring everything from how to use RenderMan to how to design a compelling character to how to develop a unique artistic voice. So as people are interested in developing their skills, anyone can do that. You don't necessarily have to win the challenge to be a winner. My advice to people that want to take part in the challenge is to start right away. The deadline is November 10th. The more time you spend on it, the better chance you have at doing well in the challenge.
This teapot is made for walking, that's just what he'll do. And one of these days, this teapot's gonna walk until he's...
The new teapot is an alien teapot. It has a little antenna, and it's green. We have a green one, and we have a gray one. I wanted something that tied RenderMan XPU and the XPU files to Elio, and I thought a classic alien teapot would be perfect.